sure you could find it. You could either find it on the Rossman Institute website, or you could just look on YouTube under the search for Dessau Einstein. I'm sure it will show up. It has this ghastly freeze frame meme. It looks like somebody just stabbed me in the back or something. I don't know how they decided that just that particular frame should be the, you know, who decides these things. But it's worth looking at just to see that. Imagine, you know, all the ghastly expressions you see on my face that you don't get to freeze because you're just sitting here in front of me. You get to see that one permanently, immortalized. Because there was a bunch of, I don't know if any of you noticed this, there was a bunch of events around here having to do with the 100th anniversary of general relativity. So there was, this included an exhibit of sort of Einstein memorabilia at that space.com, I forget what it's called. Sort of on Carlin Street or something space about it. And then there were five or so lectures at the London Public Library. So there, I think you could watch them all on different aspects of Einstein's philosophy and how they relate to different parts of the science. But mine was sort of the inaugural lecture, kind of overview of what's of philosophical interest about Einstein's theory. And so you might find that interesting. Well, you set the bar too low.
Yeah.
If you said six, you could be a free man right now.
I didn't think you're gonna take
it
seriously.
I spoiled something.
Yeah.
He wanted me to cancel class if fewer than five people showed up, and so you kind of ruined his scheme.
No, I think I said five or less. So five would still constitute canceling. Five or less.
You could just remove my person related.
Did I say less than five?
Yeah, you did.
Oh, God.
Thanks, Ed.
Yeah. Well, unfortunately, this is completely voluntary. You could just leave and consider it canceled from your point of view. Did anybody have any questions about the introduction of Machian questions? I talked two days ago, about the two points that Mach made about Newtonian mechanics and the whole idea of absolute rotation. It's a very old idea that goes back to Leibniz, you know, in Newton's own time, saying, well, if we have a relativity principle that applies to rectilinear motion, if you have uniformly moving frames of reference, this isn't how Leibniz put it. Leibniz was kind of confused on the difference between rectilinear motion and uniform rectilinear motion, not finding it in there. But the basic idea was, well, everybody, Newton will tell you that if you have one frame of reference that's legitimate, and you identify the forces, masses, and accelerations there, and you have another one that's moving uniformly relative to it, then they're equivalent. That's relativity. Uniform motions in a straight line are relative. But a rotating frame of reference is different. Now, why should there be a difference? And it bugged people. But there was no reason for it to bug them in a way, because Leibniz, just as much as Newton, believed that there really was something special about uniform motion in a straight line. Because it was a basic law of physics for everybody, you know, for the past several hundred years, that a body that's moving uniformly in a straight line is in a different physical state from one that's accelerating, right? So it's not like an arbitrary distinction. Because it takes a force to make you travel in an accelerated path, right? That's why uniform motions are special. So rotations really are different, because a rotation, if you think about it, you can have a particle moving uniformly, but you can't have a particle rotating. Anybody think of why that would be? It's not obvious at all. It's not like a trick question you should know the answer to. I just wondered if anyone had ever thought about it. If you take a body that is rotating, take, say this disk, right, and you think about it in space-time, right, but don't think about it in space-time. Think about it in space. You're looking down on it. What does it mean to say it's rotating, right? Well, it means pick any two points on it. Just start out for simplicity. Hit this one and an opposite one. Well, this one, if it's rotating, this one's velocity is going this way, and this one's velocity is going this way. Or if you pick two that are really close together, well, this one's velocity is going this way, and the next one's velocity is going in a slightly different direction. So when something's rotating, the different particles that make it up have different velocities. If you have one particle, it doesn't even make sense to say that it's rotating or not, unless it's a large enough particle to have parts. But if it's a point particle, whatever, you know, point particle is an idealization anyway. But if it's, you know, if it's big enough to rotate, it has to be big enough to be thought of as having at least two pieces, right? So then you can say, well, here are these two pieces of it, and the pair of them are rotating because this one's velocity is this way and this one's velocity is that way. And then if you look at it in space-time, you can say, well, this is what's happening, right? Every one of them is on a kind of curved path, whereas if you thought of a body that's not rotating, well, all of the particles on it are moving in parallel lines, right? Not in this, in this helical motion. And this is kind of a side issue, but if you're interested in the geometry at all, you can think of, and if you think of special relativity, right, for any world line, you can think, well, that an observer on that world line has a succession of planes that are orthogonal to that world line. Right? And those are the lines that represent simultaneous events, right? The points, right, that may represent simultaneous events. So you would think, if a body was rotating, in special relativity, you could characterize it geometrically by saying, if it's not rotating, well then you could imagine, or you know, it doesn't have to be, you know, however you want to draw a non-rotating body, it's a bunch of world lines that are parallel to one another. Right? Because the different parts, if you're, you know, if you and I are standing on a rotating disk, if we're all standing on a non-rotating disk, sorry, then our positions don't change, and also through space-time, we're all moving on parallel lines. Whereas if we're on a rotating disk, then our positions relative to one another don't change. But in space-time, each one of us is doing this, right? So you could say, according to special relativity, a non-rotating body is like a bunch of parallel world lines that can be cut by an orthogonal hypersurface. Whereas if you try to cut these, you couldn't cut these with a hypersurface that's orthogonal to all of them. You could imagine, like, if you take a handful of dried spaghetti, right? You could imagine slicing through it perpendicular to all the strands of spaghetti in your hand. Whereas if they were cooked and you sort of braided them into a rope, then the same slice wouldn't be orthogonal to all of them because they'd all be curved. So the reason why nobody ever did anything about, you know, the reason why even those people who sort of had some philosophical idea that there's something arbitrary about the distinction between rotating and non-rotating, the reason they never did anything about it was because they really all still believed in something like Newton's principle of inertia. So they all really, in effect, right, assumed, they made assumptions that were incompatible with the idea that rotation and uniform motion are equivalent. They made assumptions that implied that there's something special about the state of inertial motion. So they'd be going against their own assumptions by trying to throw away this idea. So what made Mach different was, he said, well, the law of inertia is an empirical law. We shouldn't try to say, well, if the universe were empty, there would still be something special about uniform rectilinear motions. What we really have observed in the history of physics is that if you track motion relative to the fixed stars, right, you never actually see any uniform motions, but the motions that you do see are such that every acceleration corresponds to some mass being acted upon by another mass. So Newton's laws, you shouldn't think of them in this abstract way, that they would be true even if the universe was empty. Newton's laws express how motions relative to the fixed stars are affected by the distribution of masses. So you just should state the laws of motion. Well, let me go back to something I said last week, right? If somebody says, well, I know what would happen if you took all the stars away, a body that wasn't subject to forces would still move uniformly in a straight line, just in empty space. And Mach's answer to that would be, well, the laws of motion do imply that, but you're treating them as abstract principles, not as empirical principles, because the empirical principles are statements about what you've actually observed. What you've actually observed is motion relative to the fixed star. So you just shouldn't pretend you know that these abstract laws are true. And of course, the other thing he said is, well, since these abstract laws shouldn't be assumed to be true, you should at least be prepared for the possibility that there really is a relationship between the distribution of the fixed stars and inertial motion. So this is what leads us to this argument by Einstein, who really added another kind of philosophical dimension to it by this example he gives. And you might have noticed he gives an example of the stove, right? You have two pots sitting on a stove, each with water, and one of them is boiling, and one of them isn't, right? Well, you're gonna look for the cause of this difference. And if somebody tells you the cause is something completely unobservable, you'll say, well, you haven't really finished looking. Let's look under the pot and see if there's a flame under one of them, right? Or an induction coil, or you know, whatever. If there's something under there causing one to be hot and the other not. That's just how you do science. So he says, well, consider this Newtonian case. Imagine you have two spheres rotating relative to one another, right? Just imagine this is an imaginary line, and relative to one another, they're rotating. But one of them looks like a perfect sphere, and the other one is sort of bulging out at the equator and exhibiting some other signs of centrifugal forces. Now Einstein says, we want to know the cause of the difference between these two things. Newton would say, well, the centrifugal forces tell you this is the one that's really rotating. That's, you know, that's just an inference from the laws of motion, and of course that's also true in special relativity. Now why? Well, this is how Einstein puts it. Imagine, well, construct two frames of reference. One is the frame of reference S1, right? Sorry, call it R1, right? Some calls it R1, and this is sphere S1. Frame of reference R2 and sphere S2. So the frame of reference R1 is the frame of reference constructed by people, like, suppose, people standing on S1, who think they're at rest. The frame of reference R2 is the people standing on S2 who think they're at rest. So anyone can have a frame, you know, you can imagine anybody can be at rest if you like, and construct coordinates on it. If it's not moving too violently, you can sort of, you know, pretend you're at rest. But of course the Newtonian says, well, the frame of reference R1 is a good frame of reference. It's a correct frame of reference because the laws of motion are true in this frame of reference. Whereas the people who live on S2, they observe accelerations that have no physical cause. Right? The laws of motion aren't true in S2 because there are accelerations that are happening with no forces causing them. Now the Newtonian will look over there at those accelerations and say, those are centrifugal accelerations. They don't have a cause in the sense of an external force pushing anything away from the center. The reason they're happening is because that's a rotating frame of reference. So this is what Einstein's essential philosophical point is. And it's not at all clear, I think, whether it's a good point. But the point he makes is this. The Newtonian explanation, or the special relativity explanation of the difference between S1 and S2, is this frame of reference, the difference between these two frames of reference. That's not an observable thing. If you're going to explain the cause of an observable effect, you have to point to an observable cause. And that's why Einstein says it must be true that the other masses with relative to which you observe this rotation are somehow involved in the cause of the difference between this sphere and this sphere. And of course, the Newtonian would look at this and say, well, that's really beside the point. Some people pointed this out back in Einstein's time. What I've done is I've given you criteria, and I've told you what I mean by absolute rotation. I've given you criteria for recognizing a rotation, but there's nothing wrong with my theory. I'm not saying that space is the cause of centrifugal forces. I'm saying rotation is the criterion of centrifugal forces are the criterion of rotation. And I'm telling you, you'll be able to tell from centrifugal forces if a force is acting, right? If the frame of reference is rotating. I've given you these, I've made it into a completely empirical concept by just telling you. So, I mean, if I were Newton, I would read Einstein's papers and I would say, well, what I've done is the same thing you did when you said, here's my criterion of simultaneity, right? And I've given you empirical criteria for distinguishing simultaneous events. And as long as my criteria always enable you to tell whether something is rotating or not, then you can't criticize me. You might have a better theory, but there's nothing really fundamentally wrong with my theory. If you have a better one, go ahead. Einstein thought that this was what he called an epistemological defect, because there's something unobservable about reference frames. And therefore the theory shouldn't make an essential appeal to them as a cause. It's not really clear what kind of an argument this is or if it really works. Some philosophers were really impressed by it, and they thought, well, this is what Leibniz was trying to say 200 years ago. This is something that philosophers have always felt, and now Einstein's made it precise, that there's something wrong with the concept of absolute rotation because space is unobservable. Whereas, the Newtonian view was, nothing could be more observable than the simple criteria that I've given you that enable you to tell if something's absolutely rotating. So the question is, what can you do with this? If Einstein had just given that argument, everyone would have said, well, he's some kind of disciple of Ernst Mach. He doesn't like Newton's theory. Big deal. Well, what Einstein did that was really interesting was not so neatly related to this argument, but kind of inspired by it. And that is to take the idea of an inertial frame and really give it a searching analysis. Is there something wrong with the distinction between inertial frames and non-inertial frames? This argument kind of suggests that there is, but it doesn't really tell you what to do. It tells you, well, there must be some way in which the distant masses that you can observe are involved in this local distinction between rotating and non-rotating, because the distant masses are observable in space, isn't it? What made Einstein's theory stick was that it wasn't just this sort of abstract philosophical idea that there's something epistemologically wrong about blaming the difference between rotating and non-rotating bodies on inertial frame. He actually studied the idea of an inertial frame in connection with gravity. Now, there's a peculiar fact about gravity that was first noticed by Galileo. And that is that gravity has the same effect on all bodies, at least near the Earth's surface, right? If you drop two cannonballs off of the Leaning Tower of Pisa, they're going to hit the ground at the same time, no matter how much they weigh. If you drop a hammer and a feather, they're not going to hit the ground at the same time because of the air resistance. But if you did that same experiment in a vacuum, then you would see that they do fall exactly the same way, because there's no air that's delaying the fall of the feather. In fact, when I was a child, astronauts on the moon decided to sort of do this experiment on a live TV feed, just to sort of show that Galileo was right, as if anyone doubted it by this point. And I guess it was for kids, right? They had it, somebody brought a feather just for this purpose, so that he could show a hammer and a feather dropping to the moon at the same rate. But it wasn't that long after Galileo was dead that experiments like that were done in a big evacuated glass jar. And then Newton came up with this brilliant plan to test it really precisely experimentally by taking pendulums, long pendulums, hanging from his ceiling. And at one end of the pendulum, he had identical wooden boxes. So he would put different materials in the boxes. So because the boxes were identical, then they'd all have the same air resistance. So you were sort of factoring that out. But if you filled the boxes up with, say, lead shot, or stones, or wood shavings, or breakfast cereal, or cotton balls, all these things that Newton put in the different boxes to see if different materials would fall differently in the same gravitational field. Because he figured that if you let these pendulums swing long enough, then if gravity was affecting any of them slightly differently, then eventually the periods of these pendulums would start to disagree. And so he did these experiments so carefully and over such a long time that he was able to establish that gravity's effect on different bodies of different masses and different constitutions is identical up to something like 3 decimal places. And of course, in Einstein's time, just before Einstein's time, experiments like that, better experiments were done to establish this even more accurately. So, and if you in our time, of course, these experiments have continued in the past 100 years, and it's even more accurately established now than it was for Newton. But Newton did another kind of experiment, not an experiment, an observation. He actually considered know, if you consider what you can put in a little wooden box, right, you have small laboratory-sized masses, then you might ask the question, what if the difference between the masses was huge? What if you were comparing the sun's gravity acting on Jupiter as opposed to the sun's gravity acting on one of Jupiter's moons? Now that's a huge difference in mass. And you could, it might be that there's no difference for little, you know, boxes full of stuff, but there is a difference when the difference in masses is so great. So Newton just did a calculation asking, well, if the sun acted differently on Jupiter and on its moons, what would happen? And he calculated that the orbit of any one of those moons, just pretend for a moment this is the sun, the orbit of any one of those moons would have a kind of special polarization in the direction of the sun. It would be, the sun's direction would always be, they wouldn't be indifferent to the direction of the sun. The orbit would have two poles, so to speak. But, again, you know, the observations aren't as accurate here as they are when you're in your laboratory, but within the limits of observational accuracy, he figured, the action of Jupiter on the sun, sorry, and the action of the sun on Jupiter and the sun on one of Jupiter's moons is pretty much the same. Now, it's not exactly the same, because if you think of it, you have this law that says the power of gravity depends on 1 over r squared. And so you imagine, you know, here's Jupiter and its moons, right? There's two things. One is Jupiter and its moons are never at exactly the same distance from the sun, right? So r is always different. The other thing is, well, if you're on opposite sides, say, of your orbit, right? Or if two moons are on opposite sides of their orbit, two of Jupiter's moons, right? This one and this one. Well, their accelerations are different because one of them is they're all pointing at the center of the sun, right? So the sun isn't acting exactly the same way on all of these things. It's just that Jupiter is so far away from the sun. You know, the whole system is tiny compared to the distance between Jupiter and the sun. And so the difference between being, you know, in on one part of your orbit around Jupiter and another is just too small to pay attention to. This was a problem that Newton figured out because he and his astronomer friend Flamsteed, the royal astronomer, who's always bugging him for information about these things. Why is it that the system of Jupiter and its moons is so simple? Whereas the system of the Earth, the Sun, and the Moon is really complex. And the answer he came up with was, well, if you think of, you know, the Earth, the Sun, and the Moon, right? You've got the Earth rotating or revolving around the Sun, the Moon revolving around the Earth. And there's always some triangle that represents the, you know, the positions of the three. And the size of that triangle is, you know, not negligible because the Earth isn't that far away from the Sun. But Jupiter is so much further away that you can pretend it's like a dot compared to the distance from the sun. And this is an interesting point in a way, because it's part of how Newton figured out that the force holding the planets together really is gravity, because it has the same property that gravity has of having the same action on all bodies at the same distance. Now what that means is something that Newton didn't contemplate in the way that you would think about it, but he contemplated it this far. You take the whole system consisting of Jupiter and its moon, right? It's obviously orbiting the sun. It's moving in a non-uniform way, right? The whole system is. You take its center of gravity. Well, its center of gravity moves in an ellipse around the sun. It's not moving uniformly in a straight line, like something that's not subject to a force. If you turned off the sun's gravity, then it would go off on a tangent, moving uniformly in a straight line. But it's not an inertial frame. And yet, you can pretend it is, because the forces acting on it are almost equal. The differences between them, the forces acting on all the different parts of it, are so nearly equal that they can be neglected. There's more description of this in that article on inertial frame. But Newton's idea was, well, if you look at the system of Jupiter and its moons, you can't establish universal gravitation unless you can show that the system is held together by the same force that holds the moon in orbit around the Earth. Because we know that's gravity. And you can't establish that for the system of Jupiter and its moons unless you can analyze the forces at work that Jupiter exerts on the moon. But what if it's not an inertial frame? How do you separate the actions of, say, the sun on the whole system from the actions of Jupiter on its moons within the system? And Newton's answer was, well, you can treat it like it's an inertial frame. You can pretend it's at rest or moving uniformly, because the differences between the forces acting on the different parts of the system are too small to notice. Now there's a phenomenon that you probably have observed on video at least, namely weightlessness, right? If you look at, have you ever seen video of people sort of floating around in the space shuttle or the space station? They are weightless. Does anybody know why that happened? Why don't you feel any gravity when you're in space? When I was a child, I was told that it's because there's no gravity up there, which is kind of stupid, because then we'll be holding it in orbit. There's plenty of gravity up there. The reason why people feel weightless is basically the principle discovered by Galileo. The Earth is having the same effect on them and everything around them. Right. So there's slides on this online. What does that mean? Well, you could say, well, if you're in, say, the space shuttle, right, and you're standing here, and your friend is standing here, well, you're not standing, you're sort of floating around, right? The Earth's gravity is acting on both of you, and it's pulling you toward the center of the Earth, right? But this shuttle is so small compared to how far you are away from the Earth that it's like a dot in comparison to that distance. And therefore, the Earth's action on you and your friend is pretty nearly equal. So basically, it's like two things falling from the Leaning Tower of Pisa. Well, the Earth has exactly the same effect on both of them, or almost exactly the same effect on both of them. Right, if somebody takes out a sandwich in an orbiting spacecraft, holds it up and it floats there in the air, why is it floating in the air? It's the same reason why if you jumped off of a building, right, and took a sandwich out of your pocket and just let go of it, it would just, from your point of view, it would look like it's just sort of floating in the air. because you're falling, and it's falling at exactly the same rate, because gravity has the same effect on everything. Everything that Newton knew about, right, all sort of massive bodies would fall at the same rate in the same gravitational field. Einstein said, well, let's treat this as a kind of exact law. Because if there's anything in the whole universe, if there's any force or any phenomenon that doesn't obey this law, that gravity, that it behaves exactly the same way in falling in a gravitational field that it would just in an inertial frame, then the whole general theory of relativity would be impossible. So, but let's assume that until we see any evidence to the contrary, that everything really does behave like that. Have you ever seen science fiction movies where usually they just don't explain it, right? People are on a spacecraft, they're acting like they're in the Earth's gravitational field, it's all normal. They're walking around. You know, they put cups of coffee down on their desk. And all this happens is if there's gravity up, you know, on their spacecraft, and it's as if they're in an office building or on a water ship on the surface of the Earth. And usually they don't explain this. You know, the science fiction story never tells you what is supposed to be causing this gravitational-like effect. You could imagine that you could have a kind of magnetic field that was imitating gravity, for example. And everybody would have to wear some kind of magnetized clothing so that it would work. If it was just on your shoes, then you'd kind of feel like, well, the rest of you is being pulled in some other direction, if just your feet are pulling down on you. So it would be better if all your clothes were magnetic, too, so it would be more evenly distributed. Even then, you might have to wear a hat, too, maybe, so otherwise your neck would feel the strain. But gravity isn't like that, right? Because gravity affects everything more or less equally, and the only strain you feel is your body pressing against the floor. You don't feel part of you being yanked upward. It would be like, you know, if you had, say, it would be like hanging from your feet, right? If you just had magnetic shoes on. And if you weren't sure, and you were captured, you put on some spaceship, and you didn't know if it was artificial gravity or not, you could find something that's non-magnetic and see if it falls, right? And a piece of wood, you could check. If it was a magnetic field imitating gravity, then this piece of wood won't fall. It's kind of what Einstein had in mind. So if there's anything that doesn't obey this law, then I won't be able to do my general theory of relativity, but in fact, everything we know about does. And that's what makes gravity different from any other field, right? That's what makes it different from magnetism. Magnetism only applies to charged bodies, but gravity acts on everything. So I don't know that much about science fiction. The only science fiction scenario I know about where they actually explain how you had an imitation gravitational field was a movie called 2001. Has anybody ever seen it? 2001. It was made in 1968. It was a big deal because it was the first science fiction movie with sort of realistic looking effects of spaceships. And one of the reasons it's remembered in philosophy is because it had this computer named HAL that was running the ship that turned out to be evil and had a mind of its own. I wish I could tell you what the movie was about, but I've never been able to get all the way through it without falling asleep. But I do remember the interesting part at the beginning, and that is they just show you how they have an imitation gravitational field in this space station. So it's like, it's a circular space station, and if you can imagine this, the floor of it is the outer rim. So if you were sort of living there, it would be like, you know, this is where you stand, and this is your desk, and this is your cup of coffee on your desk. Like. But the circle is big enough so it's, you know, it doesn't feel like you're in a hamster wheel or something. Now this is a totally Newtonian thing. You don't have to know anything about any post-Newtonian gravity theory to figure this out. But I believe it was, I don't know if it was the idea of the guy who wrote the science fiction story, Ray Bradbury. I don't know whose idea this was, but it's a totally, it's something somebody could have thought of in Newton's time if they'd thought of a space station, and that was, if you built the station this way and it's rotating, right, then everything in it will feel a centrifugal force. And if you know that, you know, the acceleration you feel due to gravity on the Earth in normal circumstances is 9.8 meters per second per second. In other words, an acceleration of gaining 9.8 meters of velocity every second. Now, it's a simple calculation using something discovered in Newton's time. Right? The centrifugal force depends on the velocity of rotation squared over the radius. So you can figure, well, how fast would this a disk this size have to be rotating? I mean, you don't have to, I'm not going to ask you about this calculation later. It's just to show you, it's a simple Newtonian thing. How fast would it have to be rotating, given how big it is, in order for the someone standing on the edge of it to feel an acceleration toward the edge of 9.8 meters per second. And so I don't know what the answer is, but because I don't know how big the thing is supposed to be, but the point is it would be simple to do, right? These would be engineering problems, not theoretical problems. And then you could say, well, if somebody was standing here and there's a centrifugal forces aren't like magnetism. They're sort of like gravity, in that any mass would feel the same centrifugal force at the same distance from the center. And if you put your cup of coffee there, the centrifugal force will hold it onto the desk, and it will hold the coffee in the cup. You know, you may have done that experiment, you know, when whirling a bucket of water around. That's how I first heard of centrifugal force, right? You have to whirl a bucket of water around and see that the water stays in the bucket, right? So this was some science fiction writer's idea of how you could have an imitation of gravity on a space station, use centrifugal force. But the key is that centrifugal force is an inertial force. It just acts equally on everything. So the weight you'll feel of yourself on the floor will be 9.8 meters per second, roughly. I mean, the acceleration you'll feel, the weight you'll feel, is your mass times the acceleration you're feeling toward the floor, right? So that will feel normal to you, and when you put your coffee cup down on your desk, which is being held down by the centrifugal force anyway, the cup will stay there, the coffee will stay in the cup. If you drop the cup, it will fall to the floor at the same rate as if you dropped it on Earth. Right? You'll have a perfect imitation of the gravitational field using the centrifugal force. Well, that's a peculiarity of gravity that was really interesting to Newton, because again, you know, he wanted to make sure, well, how do I know I can treat Jupiter and its moons as an inertial frame? Well, the sun's gravity acts equally on everything. He even asked himself this other question, well, how do I know that all my inferences about the forces at work in the solar system are correct? What if the whole solar system is being accelerated by some stars far away? And Newton's answer to that question was, well, if there is such a force, it's acting pretty nearly equally in all parts of the system, so you can pretend, right? You can pretend that the frame is an inertial frame, because it's close enough. And this is the idea that, you know, Newton didn't do anything with that, as far as, he didn't think of how that might lead to a new theory, but Einstein did, because Einstein asked the question, well, is there something wrong with the idea of an inertial frame after all? Because imagine, it's kind of the same reasoning that goes into the that space station idea, right? If you're, suppose you're standing in a box, and the box is at rest on the Earth's surface, and you drop something. Well, everything, you drop things to the floor, the weight you feel on the floor, all that is how gravity normally works, right? Now, suppose that if that same box were not in the Earth's gravitational field, but were being pulled upward at the same rate, right? If it's being pulled upward at 9.8 meters per second per second, suppose this, when I say upward, that wasn't a good way to put it, upward relative to the box. Pretend there's no gravity, it's just in the middle of empty space, and there's no masses around to cause a noticeable gravitational field. You could create the very same effect of the box sitting on the Earth's surface by just pulling the box this way at 9.8 meters per second per second, because then your inertial resistance to motion, just as in the case of that centrifugal force, your inertial resistance will cause you to feel some, the exact same thing as your weight on the floor, right? The feeling you have of, you know, resisting the forward motion of the box would be exactly the same feeling as your weight on the Earth's surface, if the numbers matched up. So Einstein asked the question, well, that means the question, you know, am I standing in a static gravitational field, or am I in a frame of reference that's accelerating upwards, that is upwards in the direction of my body, right? Is there a force pulling down this way, or is the frame moving this way and all I'm feeling is inertial resistance? And Einstein's answer is, well, there's no empirical way to tell. Similarly, if you take the same sort of box and the same thing, right, and you just drop it in a gravitational field, right, so then you have this person floating in this box. If you throw the whole box off the CN Tower, right, or some very tall building, well, there's no reason for you to get closer to any side of the box as it's falling, because it's all falling at the same rate, right? You're not going to fall faster than the box and sort of catch up with the floor. If you empty your pockets, right, your coins, your pocket comb, your cell phone, right, all those things are just going to fall at the same rate you're falling, which is exactly how you would feel if the box were just in the middle of empty space and there were nothing, no forces acting on it at all. Right, imagine if there's no gravitational force, then anything you took out of your pockets would just sort of float there. But here, in this case, there is a gravitational force. It's just pulling everything equally in one direction, and therefore it seems like there's no gravitational force. So you can ask yourself another kind of question, right? The same, a similar kind of question. Well, am I in an inertial frame, floating freely with no forces acting on anything? Or is my frame falling in a gravitational field? It's sort of like Newton's question when he said, well, can I just ignore the possibility of the whole solar system being part of some bigger system? Yes, I can, because if there are forces acting, they're tiny. The differences are tiny and they're negligible. What Newton didn't ask, that Einstein asked, because it was 200 years later, and he already had this idea from Mach that there was something wrong about the distinction between inertial frames a non-inertial frame to say, well, look, actually, gravity is a very peculiar thing. It undermines the distinction between inertial motion and accelerated motion. Inertial frames are not absolutely distinct. It isn't possible to tell whether you're in an inertial frame or not. So in other words, if you think of the, just sort of abstractly, well, is there something wrong with the idea of an inertial frame? Well, that's kind of, that's an argument that really goes nowhere. But if you ask the question, ask that question and ask, well, how do inertial frames behave with respect to the force of gravity? That kind of gives it some teeth. That then becomes a sort of, not just an epistemological problem, but a problem in physics. There's something peculiar about the way gravity works that undermines the distinction between inertial motion and accelerated motion. And that's what points the way to a general theory of relativity. That's when he started calling the other theory the special theory. Because that was a theory that just said uniform motions are relative. There's a special class of frame, the inertial frames. The general theory is based on the idea that, well, that distinction actually is undermined by gravity. Unfortunately, I have to get somewhere quickly, but if you have any questions about this, you can ask them on Monday or write to me over the weekend. Have a fun weekend.